Okay. Okay, yeah, okay, good. So, welcome back. Today is Friday. So, this Monday, yeah, we stopped at this point talking about the faster computer and faster algorithm. So maybe I quickly go through this part again. Yeah, because this I stopped, I rush on Monday. Maybe I go through it. So if you want to, yeah, let's say we want to compare given an algorithm, whether you have a faster computer or you're trying to improve an algorithm, which one is the better option? Yeah, here we're trying to compare. Given a same problem, then we trying to compare a computer. Okay, we trying to compare a computer, an old computer, which can execute 10,000 basic operations per hour. Another new computer, which is 10 times faster. That means it can run 100,000 basic operations per hour. So one is 10,000 basic operation. The other one is 100,000. So we want to see, yeah, what is the largest problem size the new computer can solve in an hour? Yeah, compared to old computer. So we compare a few problem. One is the linear problem. And then one is the linear logarithmic, faster one, yeah. And then exponential. Okay, so here we are going to compare. Maybe this one, yeah. We're going to compare five algorithm. This is their time complexity. So the first two is the linear algorithm. The third one is the linear logarithmic algorithm. Then this one is the quadratic algorithm. The last one is the exponential algorithm. Okay, so this is the first column. So the second column trying to tell you that this is the largest problem size you can solve by the old computer in an hour. That's in 1 hour, you only can execute 10,000. So 10,000 operation, you can handle how big the problem size is. What is your N? How big the N you can have? Yeah, so that you can complete the whole program in an hour. Similarly for N prime, which is instead of 10,000, now it's 10 times faster. That's in 100,000 operation in an hour. Yeah, so in 100,000 operation, you can handle how big the problem. So for example, okay, let's say this first algorithm, which is a linear 10N. Not surprising because 10,000, 1 hour you can handle 10,000 operation. So that means this old computer only can run. You only can let your N equal to 1,000. We have 1,000 times 10,000. So 1 hour, you only can handle 10,000 operation. So this old computer only can handle 1,000 problem. Yeah, the problem size only can be 1,000. So similar, the new computer is 10 times faster, not surprising. For the linear problem, you increase 10 times. So you can handle 10,000. 10,000 times 10. So it's 100,000. Yeah, just nice that you can complete this program in an hour. So if you compare the changes, yeah, so now improve 10 times. Yeah, not surprising. A linear problem, you improve your computer 10 times. The process, everything will improve linearly 10 times. Similarly, for the next one, when this linear problem is 20N, your old computer only can handle the problem size up to 500. Then the new computer can go to 5000. 5000 times 20, which is 100,000. So 1 hour, you can finish the program. So overall, it's a linear, so improvement is still 10 times. The problem is the next one. When you're talking about a linear logarithmic, the largest problem size you can handle become 250. Then you improve 10 times, you use a 10 times faster computer, you can handle 1,842. That's the largest number you can handle. So you can see that actually they not increase 10 times. The improvement only 7 times only. Well, this is not the worst. If you look at the quadratic one, the old 170, the new one is 200. Then the improvement only 3 times only. Because this is a n square problem. Yeah. So the improvement only 3 times. The worst is the exponential one. Basically, yeah, you improve 10 times, there's no big changes because from 13 to 16 only. Yeah, so what does this thing trying to show you? You will find that also same thing. If it's a n square, your n is 1000. Yeah, that means n square, you need to take 1 million primitive step to run. Which is the calculated and which is the measure parameter? Which is calculated? You mean the n? Yeah, you are looking for the n in 1 hour. For example, this 2 power to n. Yeah, when you were equal to 10,000? 13. 2 power to 13. What is 2 power to 13? 2 power to 13 is 8,192. Right. Yeah. Because if you increase to 14, 14 will be 16,000. That means your computer cannot complete in 1 hour. And basically, that one is through the try and error to find out this 250. There's no direct way to solve this. Yeah. That means 5n log 2n equal to 10,000. You want to solve this directly. Basically, no way to do this. You have to through the iterative way to search. Yeah. But anyway, the key is this problem is not that. The key is like showing you that you improve the computer 10 times. Yeah, the improvement not really also improve 10 times. You will find that your algorithm, the time complexity of your algorithm is crucial. If you have a linear one, it's fine. You really improve 10 times. But if your algorithm is not linear, your time complexity is not linear, yeah, the improvement can be negligible. Sometimes can be negligible if it's an exponential function. Yeah. So here I give you another example, is the n square one. When your n equal to 1000, yeah, you need to take 1 million primitive step. But if you're trying to think a way to improve this algorithm, later you will encounter the sorting algorithm. Yeah, some are n square, some are n log n, linear logarithmic. Yeah, in that situation, you can see same problem size. You use the same problem size, your same data. Yeah, you just need 10,000 steps. So that improvement is significant. Yeah, from 1 million drop to 10,000. So improvement is easily can improve like 100 times. Imagine you buy a 100 times more powerful computer. How much extra money you need to spend? Yeah, compared to you trying to think a way to improve from n square to n log n. So the cost you need to consider. So same thing, if it's this thing, if it's a 2000, you become 4 million, then this one only increase to 22,000. So the new algorithm improved 200 times. So you can see that you buy 10, Let's say today you're really very rich, you buy 100 times computer. Yes, when the problem is 1000, you improve 100 times. Yes, you have an equivalent result. Then when I trying to handle the 2000, the problem size is 2000, you find that, yeah, the end log end still faster than yours, new computer. Yes, N is the so-called old computer or slower computer. So it's 10,000 per hour. 10,000 operation per hour. Faster one means it's like 100,000 per hour in that example. Yeah. Okay, so in short, this example trying to show you that improving the how important to improve the algorithm. That you improve, you just improve this thing from N squared to N log N. Yeah, you no matter how you improve your computer speed, of course in the faster computer, of course we always need this, but we need, I think the faster algorithm is even more important, because this thing you can, yeah, your problem size increase, the improvement is become from 100 times to 200 times. Yeah, but your computer still just improve 100 times. Moreover, I have shown you this. Yeah, nowadays the computer speed not really compared to 10 years, 20 years ago, the improvement. You want to improve 10 times. Yeah, even in the past, I think, yeah, you want to improve 10 times. Yeah, is you need to take nearly 10 years to have 10 times faster computer. Yeah, using the same cost. Yeah. So it may not be practical. Just like buy a more expensive, faster computer to solve your problem. Should be the direction should be trying to improve the algorithm. Yeah, you, like I said, even your supercomputer, you improve how many times? 10 times, 20 times, 100 times, 1000 times. I just increase my problem size from 1000 to 2000. Yeah, you need to improve your computer from 100 times to 200 times. How about if I improve, if I increase my problem size 10 times? This one you need to improve 1000 times. So so that's why you need to learn the design the algorithm, improve the algorithm, analysis the algorithm. Yeah. So that is where we stopped last week, and not Monday, on Monday lecture. So today the. So I'll cover the last part for the analysis of algorithm. Next week we'll cover the searching. Next Monday and Friday lecture will cover the searching algorithm. Then after that, week 5, Dr. Ke will take over to cover the sorting algorithm. Yeah. So this lecture we will cover the definition of big O, big omega, and big theta. So, yeah, big O, big omega, big theta are asymptotic notation used for describing the order of growth of a given function. Like we mentioned earlier, when we're talking about the algorithm, the efficiency, a lot of times, okay, sorry. I think I forgot to switch off the. I hope now it's better. Sorry. Didn't notice that. I think I forgot to switch off my earphone. Now should be better. I think I already switched off. Is it better now?
already switched off. Okay. Where is that?
Oh, okay. The drumstick, because I think I try to reduce outside there's some noise. Okay. Yes. Yeah. I hope now it's better. I already switched off all the earphone and so on and so forth. So the order of go. Okay, so now you have an algorithm. We're talking about the time complexity. We only concern with the order of grow. We're not really bother so much the constant, the multiplier, because you can see that in the previous example, if it's a problem, it's a linear function. Yeah, your improvement is always about the same, whether it's 10n or 20n. Yeah. Compared to you from the linear to linear, from linear to logarithmic, your algorithm from linear to logarithmic, that kind of improvement is more significant and crucial compared to you have a multiplier is 10 or multiplier is 20 or you plus some constant. Yeah, these are relatively less important. So when we notate the time complexity, we use this notation, asymptotic notation. Yeah, we just need to represent the order of growth. So if it's the function, the f is in OG, means that it's a set of function that grows at lower or same as g. Function g, yeah. Then if we notate f is in big omega g, that's in this function f that grow at higher or same rate as g. Yeah. So if it's big theta g, that's mean it's a same rate as g. So example. If my g is a function of maybe n, that means my f in here, I can have what kind of function? I can have, of course, I can have a logarithmic function. 13. Set the function group lower ending constant can be 2, 3 and what else? If it's a same rate means that I can have 3n here. Lower than maybe this one very hard to find anything lower than this. Yeah, logarithmic, okay, maybe base 2, 1 or base 10, 1 also can, and so on and so forth. These are the function, the growth rate lower or same. Yeah. So in this, yeah. So this is those function, the set of function can be noted as. Should be in OG. Then anything is higher than that, that's mean n square, or this one a lot, this one easy. N power to n, 2 power to n, n log n, and so on and so forth. 2 power to n, n factorial also can. Yeah, all these, they are grow at higher or same rate as g. So this one, including this portion, is in big omega g. Okay, so what is the proper? You cannot use a gut feeling to guess whether this thing is big O or big omega. What is the proper definition of big O notation? Okay, so let f and g be two function. Okay, standard two function definition. So fn is set to be ogn, yeah, and then we denote it by fn in ogn. That means if at n is bounded above by some constant multiply of gn for all large n, or more formally is if there exists non-negative constant c and n naught such that fn is less than or equal to c times gn for all n greater than n naught, then we can notate fn is in all gn. What does it mean?
It's very soft and unclear.
Again, I just now okay. Now increase. Then too noisy. I think I already increased. I worry I increased too much, then the you can hear a lot of noise outside.
Let me see whether.
Increase the level. Okay. Now should be a lot louder. Yeah, okay. So in short, what does this thing mean? This thing means that, okay, in layman term means that after this number and not, you as long as you can find, as long as I can find a number and not, and then after this number, after these problems, your problem size after this number, yeah, your fn is always, yeah, that's why I cannot open too much. Okay, yeah, so fn is definitely below your gn. I hope this. I set too high already. I think the sound. Cannot put too high. Maybe this is the moderate one. Okay, now look better. Okay, so again, one more time. So if there exists non-negative constant c and n not such that fn less than c times gn for all n greater or equal to n not, in plain English means that after this thing, after this point, yeah, onward, your n greater than n not, that's n greater than n not, your fn definitely is below some constant c times gn. Yeah. So as long as, that means as long as I'm able to find some number c, some number a naught to make this criteria, to fulfill this criteria, then I can conclude that fn is in all gn. Okay. In computer science, yeah, we can allow you to just simply write it equal. But of course, actually, this is a set of function. Yeah, should be used this notation in mathematics. But you can find a lot of books just simply write it equal. Okay, so example, your fn is equal to 4n plus 3, gn equal to n. Yeah, I just find some number c equal to 5 and not equal to 3. Yeah, then I fulfill fn is always less than 5gn with n greater than 3. So, yeah, I can conclude that fn is in all gn, or 4n plus 3 is in all n. Then similarly, this thing, fn is equal to 4n plus 3, gn is n power to 3. I, of course, not surprising, you definitely can find some c equal to 1 and not equal to 3. Then you can conclude that this thing, that's mean you can make this conclusion. Definitely, because n power to 3 definitely grows much faster. Once it's above, let's say I substitute c times n not. So n not,
So CN naught after 3. 3 times 3 times 3, which is 27. Then 4N plus 3. 4N plus 3 is 15. If I substitute N equal to 3, is 15. So when N equal to 4, 5, 6, 7, yeah, you can expect that N is always less than, Fn is always less than Gn. Yeah. So you can conclude in this scenario, based on the definition, I can conclude that Fn is in all Gn. Yeah. So that is based on definition. What I see, some constant C, 1, in this example. Yeah. That means if it's in this example, C, so it's 1 times Gn. The C and N naught is I find one. I myself find one. Yeah, I as long as I can find a C and not fulfill this criteria. Fulfill this criteria. Just try and error. As long as I can find one example proof that it fulfills this criteria, I can make a conclusion already. Yeah. You don't need to derive it, you just simply try a number. As long as it fulfills, then it's always true. This statement is always true. Yeah, you can prove. As long as it's always true. After that, n greater than this number is always true. That's when you can make the conclusion already. Remember, when we talk about all this notation, we are concerned about when n is very large. So it doesn't matter you talking about n not equal to 5 or 1000. We concern is like when the problem size is even bigger than 1000. Yeah. What will it, how this algorithm look like? How is the order, the time complexity of this algorithm look like? Yeah, so it is okay to select any C as long as you fulfill this criteria. You don't need to find exactly the point. As long as the thing is that you want to, okay, today you want to know whether Fn is in all Gn or not. So you find exactly the point, the crossing point. You find that you find this particular point, or I trying to find at this particular point. Does it matter? In the end, you still make the same conclusion. The key is whether your Fn will it be halfway suddenly above of it. Yeah, that is the thing you need to think about. Not the thing you need to concern whether you cross this line or not. You need to concern is like whether this thing starting is like that, then will it suddenly the F shoot out? Yeah. What is R? Real? Just a function definition. Your N is integer. Your function can be some real number, positive real number. Okay, in fact, you can see this one is not exactly. It just show you. Yeah, it's not exactly the this point. Yeah, it's just I trying to find some point here. I think it's somewhere here. Yeah. So another, okay, of course this thing sometimes may be not easy to use. There's another alternative definition. Same thing, define the function f and g. Okay, if the definition is here, if the limit n go to infinity, fn over gn is less than infinity, then you can conclude fn is in all gn. Yeah, I think this one is easier to do. So that means your Fn cannot, from intuitive, you look at this thing definitely smaller, the growth definitely smaller than this. Yeah, the Fn definitely, the growth rate definitely slower or equal to Gn, so that you can have this result. Yeah, maybe we try this thing again. Yeah, we try to take the limit. 4n plus 3 over n, n go to infinity, not surprising, it will be 4. Yeah, big O, big O, is it important? Okay, you want to set big O also can. The key is you need to write a big O and okay. Okay. Then GN is N cubed. Then you same thing. You take this thing 4N plus 3 over N cubed. In this example, 3 is negligible. In this example, you're talking this thing. You take limit ma. I hope you all still know how to do the limit. Yeah, 4N plus 3 over N. N go to infinity. This one is equal to 4. Nothing related to this 3. Yeah, okay lah. Maybe I do one more. Standard approach session all divide by N. So N go to infinity. So it's 4 plus 3 over infinity. So this thing will be equal to 0. So answer will be 4. Okay, this is the standard where we find the limit. Okay, same thing, this thing, you take the limit, you will find that, okay, this one is n power to 3, definitely will go to 0 1. Okay, so how about this? If you have a exponential power to n, e power to n and 4n, yeah, so this thing, yeah, that's why it's like sometimes it's not easy to use the first definition. Yeah, in this scenario you can apply the limit, will be easier to find. Yeah, how to find the limit of this one over this one, you need to recall L'Hopital rule. L'Hopital rule, that means a few things you need to take notes. L'Hopital rule got condition one. First, it must be this thing and this thing equal to infinity. This term go to infinity. When n go to infinity, this thing go to infinity. The gn also go to infinity. You need to fulfill this criteria. And then, in fact, there's another. These two must be differentiable. At 4n and e power to n must be differentiable. Yeah, L'Hopital rule. So apply the L'Hopital rule. So this thing, you take the differentiation. 4n take the differentiation should be 4. Of course, still limit. N go to infinity. Gn, yeah, this one differentiate 100 times still e power to n. So this one, yeah, is equal to 0. So which is equal to 0, still less than infinity. So you can make the conclusion. Fn is in or gn. Okay, next. Similarly, this big omega is just in the other way. Yeah, now it's like is Fn is bounded below by some constant. Just now it's bounded above. Now it's bounded below by some constant multiple of gn for all large n. Yeah, so now it's the other way. So now this guy is after n naught onward. Yeah, your Fn is always above. It's always above, yeah, C times Gn. Yeah, after some point, you always. The key is like this thing must be always above after that. Yeah. So then you can conclude Fn is in omega Gn. Yes, opposite. But this one, you find that normally we seldom use it in algorithm because, yeah, you can quite easy to find some GN. For example, my FN, let's say is N square. What other thing can be less than that? Yeah. GN can be a constant. Yeah, the problem is like whether your time complexity can be a sinusoidal function. Yeah, so can be one. You also can set is a big omega log. Yeah, because log definitely is below. So that's why in algorithm analysis, I tell you this, you still don't know how complex the problem is. Because it can be n squared, can be n cubed, can be anything. Yeah, so normally big omega, we seldom use it. Yeah, another similarly same things. Now is instead of less than infinity, now this definition for big omega, you take the limit, it must be greater than zero. So that's bound below mean, yeah. So must be greater than zero. What does greater than zero? That means this thing must be grow. If this guy grow faster, then it will greater than zero. So Fm definitely grow faster than Gn. Then your Fn over Gn will be greater than zero. Right? So anything? Yes, no. Including infinity. Can be, recall just now the example, if your limit, your Fn is n square. This one is n, is n square is in big omega n. So you take limit, n square over n, which is infinity. N square over n. Cancel. N go to infinity. This one is go to infinity, of course. So Fn is in big omega, including infinity. Okay, example 4n plus 3, 5n. Both are linear function, not surprising. You definitely can find some number to fulfill this criteria and then make the conclusion. You also can take the limit. Yeah, then it's 4 over 5. 4 over 5 greater than 0. So in any one of the definition, you can make the conclusion saying that Fn is in big omega Gn. Another example, this one is the n cubed. This one is the linear. So you can see if you take the limit, this one definitely go to infinity. Yeah, this is the example. So Fn is in big omega Gn. Okay. Okay, next one is the big theta. Same thing. Yeah. But the first one is ON. Yes. Yeah, that's okay, this is the next thing. Okay. So you will find that the next one, the big theta, is there as its positive constant. Yeah, you need to find two things, the C1 and C2. You need, this thing must be fall between the C1 Gn and C2 Gn. Yeah, so in, this one is like, this thing, when this thing must be big O, also big omega. The Fn must be in big O, also in big omega. That means it's a big theta. It's a tidal bound. Yeah, alternative, that means the limit is a constant. In other words, in plain English, that means this thing Fn and Gn actually is in the same order of growth. Like just now, you're one of them asking. Yeah, if they are in the same order of growth, they are not only big O, they also in big omega, they also in big theta. Recall just now the diagram, the G, if this thing is n, 2n, 3n,
let's say it's a linear, g is a linear function, yeah, 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and whatever will fall in this range. As long as your function is in this set, that means you are not only in big O, you're also in big omega, you're also in big theta. Yeah. So for example, this one, two are quadratic function. So you take the limit, not surprising, you definitely get a constant. You definitely get a constant number. 2/7. More precisely, I have to say this one is to be constant and non-zero. A non-zero constant. Definitely is a positive. So more correct way is like a positive constant. A positive constant. Yeah, definitely is a positive constant. Okay, so you can conclude that 2n squared plus 7 is in big theta, 7n squared plus n. So, summarize this thing. Yeah, if your limit, you take the fn, if you take the limit, yeah, your is equal to 0, then you can set that it is in big O. If you take the limit, you find that it is infinity. Then just now, I get 4 and 4/5 is also theta. What do you mean 4 and 4/5? So if as long as you take the limit, you're equal to 0, then this thing is in Fn is in big O Gn. If you take the limit is infinity, you can conclude that it is big omega. If you get it is in the constant, actually they are not only big theta, they also are big omega, also the big O. In case, do we set only the one in the big theta of other O? Yeah, they are belong to O. Because recall just now the case. Yeah. So this is big theta 1, this is big omega 1, this is big O, yeah. So those are in here, maybe I consider a linear function, yeah, those are in this, yeah, all these things definitely is big theta. So if get a constant limit, like we can choose to represent it in, yes, but you need to think about it, which one is a better representation. A lot of time you can represent in this way, it's clearer. The thing is that you want to tell people that this is a linear function. If you just simply tell people this thing, the time complexity is big omega n, people just know that the worst, yeah, you only linear, it can be your time complexity can be beyond than linear, can be something exponential, can be something in factorial, they don't know, because based on your representation you only said that the time complexity of this algorithm is n. How do I know whether it is a n squared or not, or n cubed or not? Then it's unclear. Compared to you tell people that the time complexity is big theta n. Yeah, people is very sure that this is a linear. The time complexity is in linear. Yeah, so which one is clearer? Based on your application, you need to think about it. When you choose the O, omega, and big theta, what you want to deliver to people? What you want to let people know? Yeah. So to decide which one. Yeah, it's what the message you want to tell people. If you just tell people that it's a big omega n, actually you're trying to tell people that, yeah, this thing, the best you can achieve is linear. The time complexity you can achieve is linear. But it can be worse than linear.
Okay. So, okay, this is about the O, Omega, and big data. Yeah, so you can take the limit, you can use the formal definition, yeah, to find some constant, to find some n, then as long as you fulfill the criteria, you can make this conclusion. Yeah, that based on the definition. Yeah. So, next, yeah, is how to use this represent to quantize and some property we will introduce here. Have to quickly finish this thing. Okay, use, yeah, so normally, this one I already mentioned, we use this notation to represent the asymptotic efficiency of an algorithm. So you need to select the right one to let people understand the efficiency of an algorithm. So if you set Fn is in all Gn, we said that Gn is asymptotic upper bound of Gn. So if Fn is in big omega Gn, we said that Gn is asymptotic lower bound of Gn. Then is Gn, yeah, if it's Fn is in big theta Gn, then Gn is asymptotic type bound of Fn. So when the time complexity of algorithm A grow faster than algorithm B for the same problem, we said A is inferior to B. That means A time complexity of A grow faster. That means time complexity of A maybe is something like maybe n square. Yeah, this one grow faster than n. Okay, so this thing of course is not, yeah, it's not good. This one is better lah. So it's inferior to B. Yeah. How to determine the big O notation? Yeah, again, that's in what you learn in the past 1 week. Yeah, you go and count the number of primitives, then trying to discuss the constant and multiplier, then just find out the dominant term. Then you can write down the notation in big O or big theta. Okay. Yeah. So that's why we cover the past few weeks, we cover this part. Yeah, actually this part is quite easy. You just discuss all the things. Yeah, I think normally, no. More precisely, this step is the hardest one. Yeah, you need to analyze the algorithm. After that, once you have the, you can describe the function in the time complexity, you just discuss, and you just write now, yeah. Actually, you have a 3 log n plus 3. Yeah, then you discuss a constant term and multiplier, discuss a constant term and multiplier. Then I can write it big or log n. So that's the how we write the big O notation. Okay, sometimes we also can, yeah, write in this form. Yeah, you can simply write this thing in the big theta O. Yeah, or sometimes we can write in this way. Yeah. You also can do this thing is equal to this thing. Yeah, in computer science. Like I said, in computer science, we can simply set this thing is equal to this. 3n plus 1 is equal to big theta n. All this big O notation and stuff is only used for... Yeah, normally we only use this thing in the time complexity analysis. Or space complexity. Yeah, all the complexity. Run, or some book maybe called running times of the algorithm. Yeah. So there are a few ways to simplify it. Yeah, discuss a constant. You also can, like if Fn is equal to OGn, Gn is equal to OHn. Of course, Fn is in OHn. Yeah, this is some way you can simplify. For example, Fn is 2n, is a linear. Gn is n square. Hn is n cubed. Of course, this thing, Fn, of course, Fn is in O GN. Then GN, of course, is in OHN. And then, not surprising, FN definitely is in OHN. Okay. So FN is in OGN, F2N is in O2GN. So F1 plus F2 is take the maximum. Yeah, so it's not simply plus. So you need to take the maximum. Yeah, so if it's 5N plus 3 log N, so should be equal to ON instead of ON plus 3 log N. Not true. Yeah, so F1N is in OG1N, F2N is OG2N, then F1 times F2 is G1 times G2. So this one times this one, yeah. So it's in 3N squared plus times log N is in ON squared times log N. Yeah, so these are some property, some simplification rule you can use when you do this asymptotic analysis. Yeah, so another thing, yeah, some property. Okay, similarly, this thing just I already mentioned, Fn equal to OFn. Yeah, this one, of course, if it's Fn equal to OFn, Fn is in equal to, of course, it's always omega Fn. Yeah, Fn is in big T by Fn. Reflexive. Transitive, just now the example you can see, Fn is in OGn, Gn is in OHn. So conclude Fn is in OHn. Yeah, just now already show you the example. Then the, yeah, similarly for big omega, big theta, all apply this relation, yeah, this transitive property. Take notes, the last one is only apply on the big theta symmetric. So Fn is in big Gn. Yeah. Then Gn, yeah, among these reflexive and transitive is applied to all big omega and big theta. Only this one. Yeah, of course symmetric not. Fn is in big theta Gn, then Gn you can write the other way, you can swap this, yeah, in big theta Fn, but other cannot apply. Yeah, you cannot set for big O and big omega, they don't have this property. Okay, yeah, some simplification rule actually one, yeah, you can see one of them is exactly same as the property. So okay, I think, let me see, yeah, this one big omega big theta, okay, why not. This one big theta big omega, can, why not. This one you should big O you find maximum, then of course omega not, omega should be find the minimum, right? Yeah, omega, if it's omega, yeah, should be take the minimum one, so not all way true. Multiplied one, yeah, I think apply for all of them. Yeah, this thing you just simply take one example, you will find out the answer. Yeah, basically you just try one example, you can figure out. Big omega not really. Right. Okay, so move on. Quickly move on. I need to finish in 3 minutes. Okay, this one done. Okay, last thing for today lecture. Okay, so in short, there are, these are a few typical time complexity we commonly use. Constant, yeah, you substitute some function, yeah, some formula to calculate something. Yeah, normally those are independent to the problem size. Those problem, those algorithm are the time complexity is constant. If it's a linear, yeah, for example, you do some searching, we are going to cover in next week. The sequential search is a linear function. Then some searching algorithm, some sorting algorithm is quadratic. Yeah, logarithmic. If you later you will learn the binary search, is a binary search. Yeah, binary search is a logarithmic. Then some good sorting algorithm is the linear logarithmic. Then in week 12 and week 13, when I come back to give the lecture, I was talking about some MP hard problem. Those problems are exponential, 2 power to n, 3 power to n. In fact, when you learn Monday and last Friday lecture, we teach the Fibonacci. That one, the complexity is 1.618 power to n. That one is the exponential function. So summarize different class complexity classes. Yeah, constant, find midpoints, find whatever formula. You give me formula, totally unrelated. Your array, how big it is. I just need to know the midpoint, the index. Yeah, just like the first index and the last index divide by 2, I get the midpoint. It's nothing related to the problem size. So this thing definitely is constant. Binary search, you will learn next week. Yeah, it's a logarithmic. Then linear search or sequential search is a linear. Merge sorts, insertion sorts, you will learn in week 5. It's a linear class, and then quadratic class. Then metric inversion is cubic. Then yeah, in week 12, week 13, we'll introduce this to Tower of Hanoi. Okay, this thing is the Tower of Hanoi. So maybe it's a toys game. Yeah. So yeah, it's to move this thing to here, to move this thing to here. How to move all the plate from here to here. Yeah, you will find that the number of steps take exponentially. Yeah, it's an exponential function. Then traveling salesman problem, we also will introduce in week 12, week 13. Yeah, it's a factorial. It's trying to travel all the city once. Yeah, then finding the shorter path to visit all the city once. Yeah, so that will be factorial. In short, these 2 problems, you are trying to find out all the combination. Yeah, so normally you will take very expensive cost in computation. So yeah, these are the common one. Yeah, I think substitute of this thing. Yeah, I think I have to stop at this point. So this thing are some constant I already mentioned. Logarithmic. Yeah, this is one of the example in the lamps. Yeah, you can go and try to derive it. You will find this is the logarithmic one. Yeah, not always for loop is a linear. Yeah, you notice that it's a divide by 2. So you always divide by 2. Definitely, it's not increased, linearly increased. So you won't get linear. Should be the logarithmic. And the base is not important because you always can change a base. Then this thing is just a constant. As I said, the multiplier, the constant are not important. We only concerned about the order of growth. So logarithmic. Yeah, linear logarithmic. Yeah, so this thing you will see it later. So yeah, another one is a polynomial, n square n cube. Yeah, you run 3-4 loop every time you visit all the element and do the multiplication or do the inversion, metric inversion. All these are polynomial order. Then exponential, trying to try out all the combination, permutation,
normally are exponential order. Okay, so I think maybe this thing next Monday, I just quickly go through this space complexity. So space complexity, earlier we also mentioned, is about the data, the memory usage. Instead of the number of steps, we count the array you use, the linked list you create, and so on and so forth, how many memory you need to run this algorithm. Yeah. So you are using integer or floating or character. Yeah, how it affect the complexity, space complexity. So if it's an array of n integer, of course it's big data n. So one key thing is the last thing I want to mention here is the space time trade-off. A lot of algorithm you face is like, yeah, if you want to improve the time complexity, a lot of time you need to use more memory. Yeah, a lot of time you need to save the space. That's mean implied that you need to use more times to do the computation. One good example is the sinusoidal function. Yeah, there are two ways. In the first lecture we cover, there are two ways. One is I make a lookup table. I store all the cases in the memory. Then it's like a lookup table. So whenever you give me, you want to look for sine 30 degree, then I just simply go and the lookup table to the corresponding index to retrieve the answer return. So this one is constant time. So your time is constant, but the memory is very huge. The space complexity is very huge. You try out all, you store all the possible answer in the memory. Another way, maybe you use the Maclaurin series to do the calculation. You don't need to use so many memory, but you take more times to do the computation. So this is so-called the space time trade-off principle. Yeah, you need to sacrifice either one of them to get the so-called better. So there's no, so sometimes you reach certain level, you find that there's no so-called which one is better. It depends your application, depend your available resource. If you don't have so much memory, then you have to take more times to do the computation. Sometimes you need to make the things real times, but you don't mind you have a more memory. Yeah, try to get more memory. Yeah, then yeah, you can try to use another algorithm. So it's case by case and depend your application to decide the which algorithm you should use. Okay, so I think that is the today lecture. So next week we will cover the searching algorithm next Monday and Friday. Okay, if you still have any question, you can just send me an email. And the project will be start from next week, week 4 and week 5. Depend your group is even week or odd week. Just take notes, okay? It's not online. The lab is physical lab, face to face. You have to go now to the lab to do your lab, to form the group. Especially next week, you need to form the group. If you didn't attend, we will randomly select, form the group for you. Okay, that's all today. Thank you and goodbye.